Good afternoon, everybody. I feel like there's not much I need to say because today has been incredible. And I told Kenny, I feel like I've been fighting back tears all day. Just because getting all of us together in a room worshiping, first of all, we're all worshipers and worship team members, and so it sounds amazing in here. And our breakouts have been amazing. Did you guys enjoy your breakouts today? They have been, they were taught by some incredible people, people who were leaders and have been mentors and influencers in my life in a huge way. So when I saw the lineup of all the people, I was like, what in the world happened that we got all of these people on one day? It's amazing. I want to give a huge thank you before I participate in the why not moment. I want to give a huge, huge thank you, and I want you guys to help me thank Sound Life Church for this conference. Pastor Kenny, Chelsea, Jeanette, Caleb, Pastor Cal, Doug, they don't do this just because it's fun. It's actually a lot of work to put on something like this that doesn't pertain to your regular Sunday gatherings, right? Taking on extra stuff is hard, but I know firsthand that they have a burden to see worship teams and media teams and creative arts teams equipped and invested in the local church. And I am just praying and believing that this conference is gonna see incredible days, not because of who is doing it, but because of what the Lord is doing through it, amen? So I am going to give this out really quick before I get started here, and I'm just going to pick a random person. So I'm just walking around, and I think that I'm going to give it to you because I like your sweater. Your sweater is awesome. So there's a why not moment. Did you guys enjoy the donuts this morning? Wasn't that so fun? Well, if you guys take notes, we got notebooks in our bags, which I think is super cool. If you're a note taker, I want you to write this down. This is the title of our message today and what I want to talk about in just the few minutes that we have together. And it's a message called The Cost of the Call. Ever since Pastor Tyler spoke his first phrase this morning, and in the breakouts that I've been in, it's very obvious to me that God has been speaking the same thing all throughout. And so I'm excited. This is some new, but a lot of just the same spirit. And so I'm excited to share on the cost of the call. Can we just pray together really quick over God's word? God, we thank you so much that your word is living and breathing and active. So God, I pray that for that reason, it would fall on fresh hearts. God, give us eyes to see, give us ears to hear, and an open heart to hear what your spirit is speaking to us in our time together. God, I pray that we would be impacted and changed by your power and what you're gonna do in our time together. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, if you're here in this room, you belong to most likely a team at your church. And so that means that all of us understand that there is some form of a call of God on our life. And when we look in the Word, we see that there's a whole bunch of different gifts that God gives us. There's different abilities. There's the gift of prophecy and the gift of prayer and the gift of, you know, the Holy Spirit, the evidence of speaking in tongues and all these different gifts. But one thing that we know is that all of us, even if you haven't received that specific gift, every single person in this room is called. The moment that we gave our lives to Jesus, we received a call of God on our life. 2 Timothy 1:9 says, he has saved us and called us to a holy life, right? So we know that we've been saved, and if you've been saved, then you have been called. And if you're here, it means that to a certain extent, you're already actively living out the call of God in your life. You're already using the gifts and the abilities. In other words, all of us here, we can just have real talk today, right? There's gonna be a whole lot of real talk, so we're just gonna have conversation. But all of us here understand that God didn't save us so that we could sit around, right? God saved us and he put us on this earth. We are breathing, we are living on assignment, and our only mission in life is to do what he's asked us to do. Every single one of us has a call on our life. And while the gift of salvation is free, it's something that we could never earn, that Jesus paid for us, and all we have to do is receive, there is a cost to the call that God has placed on us. For those of us who are in leadership, or even if you've just said yes to being a part of what God is doing, there is a responsibility that comes with that opportunity, and there's a cost to that call. And so I want to talk today and just give us a few different things that the cost of the call means or should mean to us. And And the first thing is this: the cost of the call means embracing commitment over convenience. Embracing commitment over convenience. I want to take just a 30-second commercial break, because I will do this everywhere that I ever am, and show you a picture of my family, because I love them. And this is my family. Everybody say, aw. So I have two little boys that are amazing. That's Manny. Who was in Manny's bass class today with Andy Simo? Was it awesome? Was it good? He is my favorite bass player in the world, tied only to my dad, who is also my favorite bass player. And he's here today. So dad, raise your hand. Just, I'm going to embarrass him, make everybody look at him. they're both incredible bass players. But I've been married to Manny for 8 years, and we love each other so much. And Nicholas and Rowan are my two boys. Nicholas is 5 and Rowan is 2. And Nicholas is like the most typical firstborn child. He's like responsible, fiercely independent. He is perceptive and just kind of well-mannered, well-behaved. He's amazing. And Rowan is so amazing. And He is sweet and snuggly, and he's the one who always wants to be with you. But what we like to say about Rowan is that he's still searching for his salvation, and he doesn't know that he's called yet, because my kids are about as alike as the color of their hair. I have 2 Mexican boys. One has bright blonde hair and the other one has brown hair. But Rowan, he was a little later to the talking game, and so he's barely started to pick up on like a ton of phrases. But before he could say even the most average words like food or good morning or good night, he took it upon himself, I have no idea where he got this, to learn this phrase. And it's his answer for everything right now. And that phrase is, I don't. And it's like attitude, I don't. Like he just looks at you and he's like, I don't. And I actually brought a video of him saying it, because I want you guys to see him say this. So let's listen to this really quick.
I don't.
See, you know I'm not lying. It's like, my husband's dying. It's like, Rowan, it's time to eat. I don't. Rowan, it's time to go to bed. No, I don't. And it's like, no matter what we call on him to do, that's his answer for everything. And although that's really funny for a 2-year-old, how many of us have found ourselves guilty of answering God that way when he calls us to do something? Man, when God calls us to go somewhere or to be a part of something or to sacrifice something that we don't want to give up, it's like, no, I don't. I don't want to do that. Don't ask me to do that. And it's true, because here's what we know, is that the cost of the call is a lot of things, but what it hardly ever is convenient. The cost of the call requires for us to serve and to give of our time. Commitment instead of convenience means that we're going to be pushed out of our comfort zone constantly. Have you ever felt like, God, I just can't get a break? I feel like the moment I get used to something, you push me into something else. Then you put another challenge in front of me. Because commitment requires that kind of sacrifice. Commitment requires for us to be all in no matter what. And embracing commitment happens a couple of different ways. And the first way is it happens when we are compelled. Commitment happens when we're compelled. Pastor Tyler talked about Paul this morning, and we're going to be talking about him a little bit in our time together. But one of the things that Paul says a lot in the book of Acts as he's going from place to place, the thing that drives him from place to place, is a lot of his scripture starts with, I am compelled. Acts 2:20, he says, and now, compelled by the Spirit, I am going to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there. And this is right where he says that famous verse, for I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race. Paul went because he was compelled. There was a drive behind Paul that made, no matter what he was going to find when he got there, worth it. He was compelled. The second thing that we must embrace if we're gonna take commitment over convenience as we answer the call is a commitment to longevity. See, because sometimes God will call us to go, but sometimes he calls us to stay. And I want to take a couple of moments just to talk about that. I want you to raise your hand here if you have been a part of the church that you currently serve in for more than 10 years. Awesome. That's a lot of people. What about for 20 years? What about for 30 years? That's amazing. Raise your hand if you are serving in the church that you pretty much were born and raised in. That is, somewhere like, I'm not 30 years old, but I was born and raised there. That's incredible. See, because if you've been a part of a church for that long, I can guarantee that you have seen the highest of highs in that church, and you have seen the lowest of lows. And embracing the call and being committed to longevity means that, and what you have demonstrated and what I applaud you for, is that you have stuck it out through the rough seasons of the life of your church. And if we can just be honest for a second, man, a lot of times it's harder to stay and do that than it is to go. It's harder to stay and weather the storm and be rooted where we're planted than to just jump ship when everything starts to feel like it's not going well. Because how many of you guys can agree that we live in a church shopping culture in America? Man, we live in this like low attendance, low commitment. Like I go here, but then I kind of go here. And then like on the days that like I wake up late, I kind of go here. And what is that? Can we just like pick a church? Like, because here's what I want to tell you. The grass is not greener on the other side. No church is perfect because it's made up of people, and people are not perfect. Only God is. And a lot of times, if we're committed to longevity and we stay the course, man, we get to see the fruit of stuff we would never see if we left. There are things that I am seeing in our 6 years, very short 6 years at Stone, that I know I would have missed out on had I left when it got hard at year two or year three. Be committed to longevity. And another way that we could embrace commitment is by taking the things that are viewed as foolishness by the world and using them for the power of God. I'm going to explain that here in a minute, because we're going to go through this passage in 1 Corinthians that I think describes the call of God on our life so perfectly, and the Word will always say it better than we can. So can we go to the Word? 1 Corinthians 1, verse 18, and it says this: "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." And verse 22 goes on to say, "Jews demand signs and Greeks look for wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength." Can I just encourage us with something? When we say yes to the call of God in our life, we are saying yes to live in a way that is opposite to how the world is asking us to live. It is going to seem completely ridiculous and so dumb, but it is exactly how God has called us to live. And I don't know about you, but in this day, in this culture that we're living in, and the amount of people that we are watching walk away from faith, the amount of people that we are watching settle for being consumed by sin is alarming to me. Because here's what I have to believe as a follower of Jesus Christ, as somebody who's completely sold out to God's mission and what he wants me to do in this world. I have to believe that it's still possible, you guys, to live a holy and righteous life. Come on, I have to believe that I can still live my life, that I can raise kids. Come on, can we be honest on the fear of raising kids in this world? Man, that was not in my notes, you guys. That we are going to be tempted by sin, and we're going to struggle with it, but we don't have to be consumed by it. And there are so many of us who in our conversations and as we're thinking about, if you're on stage, if you're in the band, if you're on the worship team, if you're on the media team, and you feel like all eyes are on you in your church, it's because they are. It's because people are looking up to you. They are looking to you because you're in a visible area of ministry, and that position requires a level of leadership and responsibility to live our lives in a certain way. So instead of running from it, let's embrace it. Let's embrace the things that will be seen as foolish by the world but can be used for the power of God. That only happens when nothing else is worth more to us than being committed to the call that he's placed on us. Amen? And the second way that that we can embrace the cost of the call is this. Cost of the call means embracing faith over pride. It means embracing faith over pride. 1 Corinthians 26 through 31 says, "Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many of you were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things, the despised things, and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It's because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become wisdom from God. That is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let the one who boasts in the Lord." Man, if you ever want to be humbled, just take that scripture and read it over and over and over again. Because here's what it's essentially saying. Not many of you were, it says, think of what you were when you were called. You were not smart, right? You were a nobody who came from an unimportant family. And it says, see, God chose the foolish things to shame the wise and the weak things to shame the strong. Here's what we can't miss there. Paul literally describes the Corinthians that he's talking to as things in order to indicate just how little he thought of their human condition. Regardless, though, God chose us. God chose us so that what? So that no one may boast before him. It is through him that we are in Christ Jesus. And here's the slippery slope that we can find ourselves as artists and as creatives. We can find ourselves depending less on our faith and more on our natural talent and ability to create, to move a crowd. And we can be just full enough of ourselves that we don't really depend much on the power of God at all. Now we know that that's extreme, but because a lot of us, our talent is natural, it's something that we grew up with. In my family, it wasn't like teach them how to sing, it was either you got it or you don't. So either you're in or you're out. My dad tried to teach me how to play acoustic guitar for 5 minutes. He was like, can you strum for me? And I was like, and he was like, it's not going to work out. Piano's right next door. Like, you can do it. I didn't end up playing acoustic guitar. I lost my place. Where am I? But we can find ourselves depending more on what we know, on our own experience, on our own talents, and less on the power of God and his finished work on the cross and his promises and his faithfulness and what he can do through us. And that is a huge, huge danger. And the reason why is this, because pride, which really is just masked insecurity, we don't have enough time to talk about that today, but that's really what pride is. When people are prideful, they're hiding some massive insecurities. Pride leads us to predictability, which is the enemy of creativity. And that's exactly what God has called us to. See, when we focus more on pride than our faith, what will happen and what has happened in a lot of our churches is that we keep doing the same things over and over and over again because we know how to do them really well. So it's like, I don't really want to take any risks. I don't really want to try anything new because I know how to do this really well, so I'll stick to what I know. Even when God is trying to take us somewhere else, even when he's trying to show us something different. See, faith is the only thing that will ever lead us to true breakthrough. Faith is the only thing that inspires and empowers us and emboldens us. As worshipers, as worship leaders, as worship pastors, I believe that we should have one goal every single time we gather, and that is to witness life transformation. That is the only goal. It's not so that we can sound good. It's not so anybody can be impressed. It's so that life transformation can be made possible, not because of us, but by how we allow God's power to work through us in our gatherings. I always tell my worship leaders, man, when you get up there, you lead like you have nothing to lose, because you don't. It's not about you anyway. God doesn't need our help. He just needs our yes. He doesn't need our help to build his church. He's been building his church far before I ever existed. It's so freeing to be a part of a church that's almost 100 years old, because 6 years seems just like the smallest little fingerprint in that. And I love that. because stone existed long before me and it's going to exist long after me. That should be our only goal when we gather, is to see people's lives changed for Jesus. And it sounds really simple, but it really is that simple. And as creatives, as musicians, as media teams, as tech teams, what we can become really, really good at is creating this false sense of hype. We can be really good at hype. But can I tell you there's a difference between hype and life transformation? Because here's the thing. We know the things that are going to get a crowd on their feet, right? Let's just be honest. We know that when we sing the second bridge of What a Beautiful Name, and we go back into You Have No Rival, if people's hands don't shoot up like somebody punched them in the stomach, they are dead inside, right? It's like, I so many times in our first service want to be like, you're dead inside. Like, did you hear what we just sang? We know that the moment that we sing the first line of worthy of every song you could ever sing, listen, that like the 5-year-old in the front and the 95-year-old in the back are all going to be crying, right? Because that's like one of those songs that just reaches across generations. The media team knows that if they design the lights and the like a blackout right at the perfect part of the bridge of Do It Again, everyone's going to explode. Their minds are going to be broken. I've seen you move. It's like everyone's just going to march around the church because it's that kind of song, right? We all have songs like that. We know the moments. We know the moments that will get a crowd on their feet. But here's what we have to be careful of, and I want us to just pay attention to this so closely, because we have to be careful that in our gatherings and in our lives, we are not cheapening the power of God by trading oil for batteries. Because you can have two lanterns and both can be lit, one by oil and one by batteries, but only one of those produces heat. And light and hype without heat can transform nothing. And I believe that we've been guilty of that. I believe that we have been guilty of getting to the place where we can almost manipulate people's emotions enough. And don't misunderstand me. Music evokes emotion. Music is emotional in and of itself. Worship is something that is a part of who we are. But when we rely more on how we can make it amazing and less on the hard work of bringing and allowing ourselves to be a place where God's power can flow through, we will have hype but no heat, and we will transform nothing. We need His Spirit. We need His power. Come on, we need Him. How many of us know it's actually possible to have a service and sing about God, but the Holy Spirit is uninvited? There was a Korean pastor who came from his country, and he took a tour of the U.S. with a group of pastors. And they toured a whole bunch of different churches, small churches and large churches. And at the end of their tour, he was sitting and talking with the other pastors, and one of the pastors looked at him and he said, hey, what would you say is your general, like, thought of the church in America? And he looked at him and he said, you know, it's amazing what can be accomplished without the power of the Holy Spirit. Man, let us not be guilty of that worship one day. We need His Spirit. We need His power. We need Him to be the one who does all of the heavy lifting. It's the only thing that will bring life change. We need to embrace faith over pride and get over ourselves and be about God's business every single time we gather in our homes, in our churches, in our lives, in the dark. Come on. We need to be in a place where faith will rule out over our selfish desires every single time. And the third way that we can embrace the cost of the call is this: we can embrace confidence over competition. We've been reading through this Corinthians passage, and if you're like me, every single time I read a letter that Paul wrote, I'm like left wondering, why was Paul so awesome? Like, he like led the early church. He was like fearless and bold, and he was smart, and he has this big like life change story. And what am I doing with my life? Like what? It like makes me wonder, like, I haven't written half the New Testament, right? It's like one of those things that you just intimidated by Paul. But one of the things that Paul also was, and after he met Jesus, after he was saved, he became one of the most humble men in the New Testament. In fact, listen how he describes himself as we kind of wrap up this 2 Corinthians passage. And it's in chapter 2, verse 1 through 5, and it says this: "And so it was with me, brothers and sisters. When I came to you, I did not come with eloquence or human wisdom as I proclaimed to you the testimony about God. For I resolved to know nothing while I was with you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. I came to you in weakness and great fear and trembling. My message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power, so that your faith might not rest on human wisdom, but on God's power." You know what I feel when I read a scripture like this? I feel such relief. I feel relief from the pressure that sometimes I can put on myself to like be whatever version of perfection or brilliance I have in my mind. Because Paul says, actually, I have resolved to know nothing. It says, I didn't come to you with eloquence or human wisdom. Paul wasn't going to the churches with some like deep, you know, long curriculum that he was going to give them that was going to take them years to understand. He says, I resolved to know nothing except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I want to encourage you, if that's all Paul needed, man, if it's good enough for him, it's good enough for me. If it was good enough back then, it is good enough for us today. I resolve to know nothing except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Can I encourage you today? Be confident in the call that God has placed on you, and be confident in the creativity he's placed in you. God has placed creativity in people in this room more so than most other people in our churches. He has placed dreams and desires, and I believe that one of the things that can rob us of our confidence and drive us straight to competition is comparison. And I'm so grateful for the world that we live in today. I am so grateful that it has never been easier than it is today to learn from other people. With platforms like Facebook and Instagram and YouTube and blogs and forums and Worship One Day and all of these incredible, incredible tools that we have to essentially have a front row seat at how others are communicating or leading or running their soundboards or, you know, designing lights and doing all of the different things. It has never been easier than it is today to learn from people. And I think that's incredible. I think you guys are all here because you guys are committed to being lifelong learners. And I think that's amazing. None of us have ever arrived at our craft, and we're always trying to improve and trying to get better. But I want to encourage us with this. This is what I want us to take away from this point today, is that whenever we're learning and we're looking up to different people in ministry, we've got to be sure that our looking and our learning from stops at inspiration and does not get to imitation. Now, we've got to be sure that we're not looking to imitate the people that we're watching. And here is why. Because they are carrying a call that God placed on their life that was not meant for you. I am carrying a call on my life that was not meant for you. You are carrying a call in your life that was not meant for me. I've got to shoulder stuff and carry stuff and walk with things that you will never have to carry because it wasn't meant for you. See, the people that we are looking at, the churches that we're looking at, the teams that we're looking at, the music that we're comparing our music to, they're busy being who God has called them to be. And the only thing that is happening to us is we are being robbed of the creativity that God has placed in every single one of us because we're too busy trying to be like somebody God never intended us to be like. And here's what we have to be committed to today, Worship Wednesday. We have to be committed to doing the hard work of figuring out what that is. Of figuring out, what is my unique contribution? What is my unique voice? I don't sound like Brooke from Hillsong. I don't sound like Carrie Job. I don't sound like Jeanette Bryant or Sandy Smith. I'm not supposed to sound like them. I'm supposed to sound like me. And if I focus on sounding like somebody else, I'll miss what God is trying to do for my church through my life. Because guess what? They don't go to Stone Church. I do. And God has a word for them that he's trying to get through me. We have to be sure that our learning stops at inspiration and doesn't get to imitation. And maybe it's just true for our team, as the person who oversees worship at Stone. Maybe it's just true for me. But have you guys ever found yourselves in your churches and you get so excited to create? It's like, you know, we should write songs and we should, you know, we should have artists come and like paint and write poems and like do things. Like that'd be so awesome. And the moment that we get excited and inspired to do something like that, we're immediately hit with this belief that it's all been done before. Like, what am I going to write in a song that hasn't already been covered at this point? Or what am I going to do that hasn't already been done before? And I want to tell us today that that belief right there is enough to keep us stuck. That belief right there has frozen so many of us in our tracks that we never actually took a step forward. Well, what am I going to do it for? What am I going to do, invent a new chord? Like, is it possible for me to come up with a new chord progression for worship music? Like, am I going to invent a new color for the lighting scene? Like, all the colors are all the colors. Like, they've always been that color. Like, how am I going to do? Can I just release us of something today? There's nothing new left. And that doesn't mean don't create. Just stick with me for 5 more seconds. There's nothing new left, and here's why. Because the songs that are being written and the messages that are being preached and the poems that are being written, they're being written based on all the same book, the Bible. And the truth is the truth. It's been the same since the beginning of time. It has never changed. Don't you think by now that besides the book of Song of Solomon and some genealogies, like every other verse has been covered almost? Unless you feel inspired to write an album on the genealogies, I don't know if I'll buy it, but if that's what God places here, do it. There's not a whole lot of new left. And you know what? That's okay. You're probably not going to invent a brand new chord progression or write brand new words. Your song, if it's going to be Christian, has to have Jesus in it, or his resurrection, or his death, or his joy, his mercy, grace, faithfulness, promises, something, right? It's not going to be a brand new thing. Guess what? We don't need a new song. We don't need a new message. We don't need new. What we need in our churches today is a now word from the Lord. We need a now word from the Lord. We need to know what are you saying to the people that I am leading each and every week right now? And if we focused less on a new concept and a new thing that God was trying to speak to us, and we focused more on the now thing he was trying to speak through us, we would never run out of things to say. We would never run out of things to write. We would never run out of things to arrange. Because here's what we know. The Bible is living and breathing and active, and his word never returns to us void. So there is always something to say. There is always something to say. The cost of the call means embracing that kind of confidence and not allowing ourselves to be so fearful of not doing something cool that we don't do anything at all. How many of us have gone to write a song and it's like, man, if it's not going to be on like the worship top 40, like what am I doing? Like I'm just wasting all my time. Who cares if no one hears it? Who cares if your church is the only people that ever receive the message of that song? See, because the message that God has for Stone now is not the message that he has for Sound Life Church. And it's not the message that he has for Faith Assembly. And it's not the message that he has for BCA or for New Life. He has a different word that he has for every single church because it's made up of different people. And when we allow ourselves to stay stuck, man, we'll be paralyzed and we won't take any risks ever. And there is so much more. I'm going to ask the worship team to make their way up here, please. There's so much more that God wants to do through us and through our churches. If we just focused on what he was trying to do now and released ourselves of the pressure of this new and shiny and amazing cool thing, and we focused more on, God, what are you trying to say now? And maybe you're thinking that, but you have no idea what it is. Man, would you ask the Lord to give that to you? God, what is the now word that you have for my people? Every single Sunday, as I get ready to lead and I walk on stage, that is the number one thing that I say to myself every single week. Because can I tell you guys, it gets so tiring sometimes when we're up there and we feel like we're playing that song again. I'm taking people to offering again. How many different ways can I word communion? Right? Like Jesus died on the cross, and so forgive us of our sins. And we can get into this place where it just becomes a routine to us because it's the same as the same as the same. And like Pastor Tyler said, every 7 days, Sunday is coming. But if we focused less on trying to rack our brains to come up with something new and we just focused on God, what are you trying to say now? Man, we would be more in sync with the Holy Spirit and what he's doing than we ever have been before. If we just decided to have an open heart and say, God, what are you speaking? And how do you want to speak through me? And what do you want to encourage your people with today? And one of the things that I know to be true is this, that if you're here in this room, it means that you're hungry for that. It means that you have decided that knowing all that you know and doing all that you do is always going to be enough, and I'll never learn more, and I'll never do more. I'll never be better than I am now. And so what is it even worth it for? And maybe some of you came today, but you still feel like that. But if you're here in this room, it tells me that you've got at least a little bit of hunger to see what God is trying to do in your church. And until God comes back, Jesus comes back for his bride, he has words that he wants to speak to us. And no matter how twisted or dark or discouraging people may get or the church may get, he's still speaking. He's still moving. He's still giving us every opportunity as we gather and as we're in community and when we're in the green room and when we're in our rehearsals to move. I wasn't going to share this, but if I'm preaching that we have to listen to the voice of God, I might as well do it, right? Because it's a powerful thing what happens when you're in community. Brenda was talking about that in her breakout this morning, and at the beginning of this year, or this summer, I started to feel really hoarse in my voice, and I thought I was sick, and I wasn't sick, and it never went away, and so I finally went and saw a specialist, and he said to me, you have a hemorrhaging cyst on your left vocal cord, and we're going to have surgery to remove it. You need to stop all vocal activity, you need to cancel any messages that you were planning on preaching. And it was like the biggest slap in the face. Because people will tell us, as creatives and as artists, that it's not who we are, it's just what we do. But for many of us, we've been doing this before we could do a lot of other things. I was singing before I could talk. I think I was 4 when I sang my first song in church. It's a part of every fiber of my being. And so when I heard that and I was immediately taken away from that, I started walking through this journey of like, God, I feel like I'm being silenced in so many ways. So this can only mean one thing. What are you trying to speak to me? What am I not hearing that you need? really rough 2 months of sitting on the front row and just having to navigate that and deal with that. And you want to know what the beautiful thing was? Is that I had a team of people that came around me and were praying for me and were walking with me. And it was at a rehearsal on a Tuesday night that they asked me to join the middle of the circle. And like I had done so many times for them, they started laying hands on me. And in that moment, I felt for the first time in my life this fiery flame that just came like all the way through my throat. And I was like, what was that? That night was coming to an end, and my husband looks at me and he's like, babe, you don't sound as hoarse as you did. And to be honest, I immediately blocked out the idea of a miracle. Isn't that so sad? Like, I had to repent of that afterwards, because I was like, no, I don't want to say that if it's not true. And it took me like a full 24 hours to actually tell him and be like, hey, I feel like my voice is stronger, but I don't know. Like, I don't want to say that it is. And that next Friday, I went to have the appointment where we were going to figure out when the surgery was and all of that. And my ENT puts his scope down my throat, and he's looking, and he's down there for about 3 seconds. And he's like, huh. And I just look at him, and he goes, there's nothing there. And I just looked at him, and as I have the scope down my throat, I said, are you serious? He's like, I'm very serious. He didn't think I was funny. He was like, I'm very serious. He just kind of pulls it out. And that was that. It was gone. And I had to go through therapy and stuff afterwards. But it was at a rehearsal on a Tuesday night as we casually gathered. And there were people at church who were praying. I was getting phone calls. My parents were praying. My kids were praying for me. And it was at a rehearsal on a Tuesday night with no lights and no people that God decided to heal me. And you know what that did for me? And you know what that should do for all of us today? Is encourage us that He's still here. He's still moving and meeting. And after every one of your services, when you're tired and you're burnt out and you're discouraged, God is healing people. You may never hear about it. You might not talk to them after the service. But if you have positioned yourself to be used by the Holy Spirit and the power of God has spoken through you, I can guarantee you that somebody's life has been forever impacted. No matter where you're at in the church, doesn't matter if you're sitting behind the computer. Doesn't matter if you're a part of picking up trash after service. Bible says, do everything unto the glory of God. He's using every part of it. And I believe that He's moving in the churches in our region. I believe that God wants to speak a now word to your teams. I believe that He wants to reveal dreams to you. And I want to ask you today, what is the dream, worship one day? Pastors and leaders, as you're leading the community that is your teams, your creative arts teams, what is the now word that God is speaking to you? What's the dream? Months and months ago, as this team was preparing for this conference, they could have never guessed the things that were going to be shared, the things that were going to be spoken. And it wasn't this pressure to do something new or flashy. It was just to do something that needed to be done now.